teacher, spiritual director, author of over 30 books on spirituality, Andrew Harvey spoke at the annual Lyceum at Unity Institute and Seminary several years ago when I was still a student out there. And he spoke on the topic of sacred activism. And when he spoke, I was deeply moved by his sharing, and I bought his book called The Hope, A Guide to Sacred Activism. And in this book, Andrew Harvey shares this very touching story. So Andrew was British, but was born in 1952 in India and had grown up like immersed in the study of the world's religious traditions. So he studied intensely the Eastern religions of the world, even studied under a guru for many years. And in the story, he shares about how in the year 2000, as part of many travels that he had done throughout his life, he ended up on a beach in Galilee. And it was on this beach, according to scripture, he says, that Jesus last appeared to his disciples. And so as he comes out to visit this beach, Andrew Harvey recalls sort of that moment of his being where he recognizes, like many of us, his love-hate relationship with the church, if you will. And he says that I definitely, at that point, had what I would call a lover's quarrel with the church. He said, but at the same time, there was something very peculiar. Despite all of his journeys and all of his studies of the world's religious traditions, he said that there's one thing that has always been on my heart, that for some reason, in the midst of all my travels, Jesus had always been the greatest love of my heart. He says that since he was a little boy, I loved him as a small boy, he said, and I shall love him until the day I die. So as Andrew Harvey tells the story, he says, when I walked onto that beach, it was just, you know, a regular beach with little pebbles out there, and he said, unremarkable on the surface. But something in that time or space overwhelmed him. And in that moment, he fell to his knees. And when he was on his knees, he pulled out a small family Bible that he had always carried with him, this little version of the Bible, and he flips it to the last chapter of the Gospel of John and reads this aloud to himself there, and I'll read it to you verbatim as he shares it. So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs. He saith unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved, because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. And Andrew Harvey relates that he knew these words since early childhood, but until that day and that moment, he had never experienced their full force. That day, he writes in his book, I understood that when the love that moves the sun and stars starts to become real inside you, it compels you to act in whatever way you can to feed my sheep. And that is how you know that you are starting to become an authentic, loving, spiritual being. When I read this story, just like when I first heard John's song, I felt a kind of heartache. I felt a heartache based on not my own personal suffering, but on the suffering of others in the world. So I connected here very much with Andrew Harvey's desire, on the one hand, to be of service to the world. And part of the heartache that he touched in me was that, frankly, when I was a little girl, I was the activist. I was so idealistic. And I remember, you know, when you're like, I was little, probably around 9 years old, I think, and I was riding my banana seed-style cloud bike down our neighborhood. Like, I'd be cruising along with those little things that fly in the back that look like flames, kind of, but they're like blue and white and fluffy clouds. But I would be preaching to the kids in the neighborhood. I'd be like, why is there world hunger? I said, it doesn't make any sense to me. Why is there world hunger? Now, I wasn't great at math, which is why I became a lawyer. But I was like, if everyone would just give one penny, we could feed everybody in the world, don't you think? And I remember telling all the kids in the neighborhood this. You know, and I was impassioned as a little girl. And Andrew's story reminded me of that passion. And that passion lived on into my teens. So in high school, I founded the philanthropy club at school. And philanthropy, for those of you who don't know, means love of humankind. So I started this club, and I was the president, and we sponsored a child in Ecuador. And I went over to Ralph's, our local supermarket, and made an announcement about our Food for All program. And I went to our city council meeting, and I had them do this petition to announce World Day of Hunger. And this was me in high school. So I was charged. But what's interesting is what happened over time. I had this fire in me, right? But the fire started to dissipate as I realized just how daunting my task was, right? And how, you know, I've shared about this before, how I couldn't get everyone to follow my script, because the moment they would, the world would be saved, you know? So I had this notion about how the world needed fixing, and I could go and do it. And so unfortunately, like many, I went through a period of disillusionment. So I want to share with you a story of my journey from disillusionment into what is called sacred activism. And I love Andrew Harvey's story here, and even what he models in his book, because it reflects my own journey through this. Because what I found is that early on in life, I had one fire, and the fire was out there. It was about the world and what I could do to be of service to the world. But what I was missing was the second flame, and he calls it the fire for God. And I had it innate in me, but I hadn't pursued it and cultivated. So I'll talk about how the journey into what is called a mystical experience of the divine is what supported me in bringing these two pieces together into where I feel like now I live in sacred service to the world from a different kind of place, a place that feels fulfilled, a place that doesn't think that the world needs fixing, but comes from a place just of innate and organic love. I share about this because the struggle in unity as a movement for many years has been this very struggle. We tend to focus on the second passion, the passion for the divine,
the passion to know this oneness and this wholeness within ourselves. But we have been critiqued as a movement for not acting more in the world. And so I want to take these two pieces together and explore how, from a unity perspective, not from a traditional perspective that says you are lesser than me, and so I'm going to fix and help you, but from the perspective that says, because you are me, let us join together and be a loving presence to support our common needs in the world. So that's what I'd like to talk about here today. So I want to begin first with this initial journey, the passion for service. So, right now, I have had many congregants, folks, friends, relatives come to me as a minister post-election, feeling an urge to do more in the world, right? To be of service, feeling an impulse to take action in ways, but feeling the struggle of like how that action can take place and how we can do it in a way that is sustainable, how we can do it from a different point of view. And so with that, I want to talk about the second passion, which is the passion for the divine. So for me personally, what happened was I lost a sense of hope early on. I went to college, and as many college folks do, I became a devout existentialist, you know, which means basically I believe that God doesn't exist, that man invented God, right, just for our own convenience, if you will. So for many years, I was a philosophy major, you know, there was a void in me and a complete emptiness. And even though I had built a life on the outside that looked pretty swell, you know, I had a great legal career. I was married to a wonderful man. I had a beautiful home in San Francisco. There was an emptiness inside of me. In my early 30s, I hit bottom in my life, and I started a 12-step program of recovery for which I was told God or spirituality is the basis of your recovery. And so it was then that I started revisiting this question of meaning, of that power that is greater than myself. But I gotta tell you, I was a philosophy major. I had researched the world's religions. I had studied with Jehovah's Witnesses for about 6 years. I had gone to Bible studies with my Presbyterian friends all throughout high school, Baptist friends. I had read the Bible on my own. I had read many different scriptures on my own, and nothing seemed to fill this void. But it was only when I found unity, and when I found that, as I kept saying, well, show me what book, what out there is going to teach me the meaning of life and how I could work this all out. At unity, they kept pointing right back at me. In you is that sense of meaning. And I'm like, me? You know, and I didn't understand what that meant until I learned about the practice of prayer and meditation. And I gotta tell you, when I first tried practicing meditation, it was one of those things where I'm sitting in a room with five other people and everybody's quiet and all you can think about is what noises your stomach's making, right? You know, that's what I was sitting doing. And then I'm peeky to see if everyone's done yet. And this is my experience. And then, you know, we're finished and then they come out and I was like, well, these are the sensations I felt when I was meditating. So that was my first experience of meditation, but I stuck with it. It was the oddest thing in the world to me to turn back and look at myself. But as I stayed with it, I found two things. The first thing was myself. That in these outer actions that I was doing as a little kid, I kind of abandoned myself. I was focused on that world. But I didn't come from this place of wholeness because I didn't know that place. And so forcing myself to sit still and come to know myself, the first thing I found were all these yucky things like judgments. You know, and I'm like, ew, I don't want to go here. Sadness, grieving, heartbreak for the world. And so I didn't want to stay, but I stayed. And I gotta tell you, meditation sucked the first few times. All I did was cry, you know? But I stayed with it. And as I stayed with it, what happened for me was that eventually, underneath the layers of muck and guck of my surface self, the part that I thought was myself, I felt light. I found this lightness inside myself, and then I got it, what unity kept pointing at to me. And it was in that experience that I came to just have inklings of an understanding of an innate wholeness that was in me. And so when unity says, you are divine, I could begin to fathom what that meant. It meant that I was whole. That even with my human imperfections, there was some innate sense of fullness in my being. And that is one of the things that I was seeking. A part of why I was suffering in the world was not because the world was messed up, but because I didn't have that sense of satisfaction and fulfillment within the depths of my own being. But here's the kicker. When in that time I was struggling so much, all I wanted to do was to learn to feel the sense of well-being and peace in my own heart, I didn't realize that this very process of going inward would actually be that which propelled me outward, but from a new place. Because the more I sat with myself, the more that existential angst and the utter loneliness that I felt for the first 30 years of my life went away. I didn't necessarily have more people in my life, but I had a greater sense of connection to all people in the world. How weird was that? Through becoming more connected to my inner being, I became more connected. Did it fall? Sorry. Disconnected with my mic. I'm watching all of you. Oh, your eyes are down there. What's going on? So interconnectedness. But my goodness. And so here's the kicker. As I sought my personal peace and well-being, as a lawyer, I had this sense of connectedness start to well up from within me. And it was from that place that I realized that practicing law would no longer work for me, because I would have to do something foundational with my life that would be of service to my fellow human beings. It was such an imperative, a compulsion for me at the time. From our quest to know ourselves, we can come to know that innate divinity, but perhaps wholeness and oneness in some ways are the same. And for me, that is the mystic's path. There are a lot of people who refer to unity as a practical Christianity. My favorite view of unity is that it's actually a mystical Christianity. It points us to the depths of being. And when we're willing to do that, there's something organically that flows. How often do people come to me and say, I don't know what is mine to do? And here in Unity, what we teach is that doing follows from being, and that we do not know how to act when we do not yet know who we are and what we are. And so this second piece, the passion for God in unity, for me, ironically, when people see out in the world these needs and they want to act out of anger or or struggle or a sense of the inadequacy of what is out there, my encouragement is not to jump out there, but to go more deeply in here. You know that saying that it's not that Christianity has failed, it's that it hasn't been tried, you know, truly? That when things get really rough, we forget to love. We forget to do that deeper work inside. We want to just go and fix this broken world instead of go within and mend our broken hearts. Somehow, I have faith. I have tremendous faith in humanity. I have tremendous faith that when we go within truly, not on the surface where we're still hearing all that chatter, where we're still upset, when our mind is still unsettled, but when we go beneath that into a ground of being, something, a new fire emerges from us. But that fire is born not out of hate for what's out there, but out of love for what's out there. And I love Andrew Harvey's words when he says this about sacred activism. Sacred activism, he writes, is the fusion of the mystic's passion for God with the activist's passion for justice, creating a third fire, which is the burning sacred heart that longs to help preserve and nurture every living thing. And he suggests that when we're really listening, really present to our lives, really awake to the poignant beauty of the world, our hearts will break not once, but regularly, so we could just expect it and plan on it. And he says, perhaps though, this is not a problem, that our hearts were meant to break just as they were meant to beat. And as he suggests, the purpose of our hearts is to just burst open again and again so that ever more beauty, love, and wonder can emerge, but from that sacred space, from that inner sanctity, if you will, from the kingdom of heaven within, is what Unity teaches. I want to share two stories that Andrew Harvey shared in his book. When we talk about like our capacity for love, I feel like sometimes I don't think we believe enough in ourselves and our capacity for love. But stories like this help to remind me of the human potential for love. And he says, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa was a body that was established after the abolition of apartheid. And it reports this story about an elderly black woman who was face to face with a white man named Mr. Vanderbrock, who had confessed to the savage torture and murder of her son and her husband a few years earlier. The woman was actually made to witness her husband's death. And so the woman at that time, the last words of her husband notably were, "Father, forgive him." So at this time, when the commissioner asked this woman how she believed that justice should be done to this man, the woman replied that she wanted three things. First, she wanted to be taken to the place where her husband was burned to death so she could pick up the dust pieces and give him a proper burial. That's number one. Number two, she said that now that she had lost her only family, her husband and her son, she wanted Mr. Vanderbilt to become her son, to come twice a month to the ghetto where she lived and spend a day with her so that she could pour out all the love that she had left onto him. And then finally, she kindly asked someone to come to her side and lead her across the courtroom so that she could take Mr. Vanderbrook in her arms, embrace him, and let him know that he was forgiven. Galatians, serve one another in love. Love your neighbor as yourself. Of course, I'm sorry that my husband's not here today, because I want to share a quote from the movie Cloud Atlas. There's a story behind it, but it's basically this movie that motivated me to agree to go on my first date with him. It said this. I'll just share what it says. It says this: our lives are not our own. We are bound to others, past and present. And by each crime and every kindness, we birth our future. We are bound to others, past and present. And by each crime and every kindness, we birth our future. And Mother Teresa, of course, said, if we have no peace, it's because we have forgotten that we belong to one another. And of course, when I shared this quote with my husband, it was this recognition that we belonged to one another, you know? But I want to conclude first by sharing a quick story. When we talk about belonging to all of life, that I'm not just talking about other human life, I'm talking about animal life too, you know? And Andrew Harvey shares this great story about a woman he knew, this gorgeous Parisian actress. He lived in Paris for a while, and she made big bucks at one time doing this one movie, and then lost everything, had her lover betray her and flee with her friend, and the woman holed up in her own little apartment for a while until, she says, a scraggly, hungry dog found its way to her. Mm. Yeah. And so that dog came and saved her life because, as she points out, we need to love. We need to serve each other. And it was in the caring for this dog that she regained her sense of her own identity, right? What I would call our divine identity, which is love. So, Andrew Harvey says this, I think this is very apropos to the unity movement. A spirituality that is only private and self-absorbed, one devoid of an authentic political and social consciousness, does little to halt the suicidal juggernaut of history. On the other hand, an activism that is not purified by profound spiritual and psychological self-awareness will only perpetuate the problem it is trying to solve, however righteous its intentions. Doing, from a unity perspective, flows from being. And we teach this, and a lot of us have practiced it on an interpersonal level. You might remember even some of Marianne Williamson's teachings, how she'll say this: if you have a lack of consciousness around money and you win the lottery, what do? You squander all your money. You might get it on the outside, but you give it away. If we have a lack of consciousness around peace, all our efforts to make peace happen in the world, we will squander away from this perspective. And so it is vital that we come back to that place within ourselves, that ground of being, where we do remember that we belong to ourselves, to God, and to one another. Right? For me, when people say, oh, you know, there's so many ills in the world because people are so selfish, I don't believe people are selfish at all. I believe people act in selfish ways when we forget to whom we belong, right? That we belong to that divine that resides within us and that we belong to one another. And how do we know what is ours to do? Finally, a last quote from Andrew Harvey. Every single corner and aspect of our lives, every single choice will be different if we act from the divine center of silence and allow the glory of the presence to soak our every movement. The Taoists said this. You remember that saying? They put a glass of water and they have this little sand at the bottom. And he says, are you willing to wait until the mud settles so that the right action will emerge of its own accord? And so in the midst of the conflicts of the world, are we willing to sit enough with ourselves to find that place of peace at the very depths of our being and allow right and perfect action that is enough, that is what's ours to do, to emerge? With that, I'm going to invite us, John, to lead us first in a time of meditation that Carrie will lead.